brought to you by the Asombro Institute for Science Education.
So my name is Michele Nishiguchi. Everyone calls me Nish. And I'm a professor of molecular and cell biology at University of California, Merced. I was previously a regents professor at New Mexico State University for 21 years in the Department of Biology. And I work on symbioses. So that is the interactions between two or more different organisms. And it doesn't necessarily have to be a good interaction, but it could be some type of interaction. And I'm interested in how they get along or don't get along. One of the things that is very interesting about symbioses is that if you have two different, entirely different organisms, you have to figure out if they can understand each other's language. So it's the crosstalk that we call it. And in particular, if you're looking at microbes, which I'm very interested in because they're very cool organisms, how do bacteria understand what the host is doing? Now you think about it, you know, we have lots of bacteria all over our inside our bodies. How do they know what's going on in our systems? If we're sweating a lot on our skin, what we eat in our gut bacteria, the bacteria underneath your armpits when you start sweating, when you're nervous. So one of the easier ways to study those kinds of interactions is you pick a model. So the model I work on is a little bobtail squid and these glow-in-the-dark bacteria that they harbor inside their bodies. And the reason why I think it's so cool is that this is a beneficial relationship. So the squid and the bacteria get along, and they're partners like in marriage. And what happens is that the bacteria glow in the dark, so they make light, and the squid harbors these bacteria in an organ called the light organ. So these guys are nocturnal, which means they don't come out during the day. They only come out nighttime. So they bury in the sand during the day to hide from predators because lots of things like to eat squid. And at night they come out and they hunt and they actually are looking for mates or whatnot. But if you think about it, if a little squid's swimming around, a little cuttlefish or like a little bobtail squid about this big, there are a lot of things that might want to eat you. And if you're swimming around and the moon is shining down because it's nighttime, you're going to cast a shadow from underneath. And so what these guys do is they use the bacteria that produce light to match that downwelling moonlight. And so basically the shadow underneath disappears. So you can think of it as the squid cloaking device, if any of you guys are Star Trek Trekkies, and they disappear. So they kind of are incognito until they actually go back and bury in the sand. And so I'm interested in how the squid controls the bacteria and how it knows when it's going to make light at the right time. But I'm also interested in how the bacteria benefit from being inside the squid. And they do. They get lots of good things like nutrition and food and a nice, safe place to be. So one of the things that's very interesting about bacteria is a lot of times it's really hard to tell who's who because they're so small. We can't see them with our naked eye. And so we're kind of like private investigators or little microbiology sleuths, so to speak. And we have to be able to identify these bacteria. And you can't really do it just by looking at shape because most bacteria are either rod or round or cocci. They can be amoeboid shaped. And so that really doesn't give you much of a description. So you have to actually look a little bit deeper. And it's kind of like looking at the fine details. So we just crack them open and get their DNA. And the DNA is the genetic code that is actually, it's kind of like your personal signature. Everyone's DNA, total DNA is unique to themselves. So we can use that signature, the genetic signature, to be able to tell the differences between, say, a glow-in-the-dark bacterium that's in a squid in Hawaii versus a glow-in-the-dark bacterium that's, say, in Australia. And so what my lab does, one of the things we do, is we actually look at kind of the diversity of all these bacteria along with the squids that they are harboring with. And so we call that population genetics or population biology. And the way it's really nice to be able to do that, not just by looking at characters, because sometimes characters can be deceiving, is we look at the DNA between those different populations. And because they have those genetic signatures, we can say, the populations from Hawaii are different from the ones, say, in Australia versus, say, ones in Japan or the Philippines. Or even you can sample all the way over in Europe, like in the Mediterranean. And we can get all that DNA data and look and see what differences exist between the same genes of those different populations. I think we can learn a lot, not just by understanding the populations, the differences between populations. It also gives us a clue of why these populations are living in, say, a warm tropical place like Hawaii versus where they're living in maybe a colder place like in Hobart, Tasmania, down in Australia. So temperature regimes are very different, but the bacteria are the same. So how can these guys live in the tropics and these guys live in temperate waters, you know? So that's one thing. But the other interesting thing about why genetics is so interesting is also, this is bringing back to not just my research, but kind of to even human research. So let's say you might have an underlying disease that's genetically linked. And if we can actually sequence your DNA and target the genes that we know are linked to that kind of disease, then we can say, you might have a higher chance or maybe less of a chance of getting that disease. And there are some good examples out there. Breast cancer genes, I don't know if you guys have studied that yet, but that's one of the ways where you can actually look at someone's DNA and see if they're more susceptible to getting breast cancer when they're older. And it's a good way to kind of have more more of a preliminary data that you can decide what kind of health measures you're going to take later on. And this goes with many, many different diseases. I think people are very interested in looking at the genetics. And I wouldn't say it's that simple, because one gene does not equal one disease. It's a variety of factors. So of course, environmental factors, we were talking about cancer. Let's say you're smoking 3 packs of cigarettes a day, you're going to be more prone to getting lung cancer than the guy that's not smoking any cigarettes next to you. And that's an environmental factor, you know. Also living in a very polluted city where there's a lot of non-clean air. Some of these big cities like, say, Mumbai in India has a lot of air pollution. And people that live in those cities are more prone to having asthma and lung-related diseases just because of the quality of air that they're breathing compared to, like, you guys in Las Cruces, where the air is really nice and clean and not very polluted. So there's a lot of other factors. You probably understand diet also is a lot, you know, you are what you eat, that's very true. So some people are more susceptible to having diabetes occur. Some of that is genetically linked, and so you have to watch your diet.